We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, just as I have a dream. That my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. One day right there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. When we let it rain from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
The first time that I toured any Civil War battlefields was with my grandmother, who lived in Lawrenceburg, Tennessee, but she was a Massachusetts native, and she was intent on making sure that I saw every Union victory in the local region. And so she took me to Shiloh and she took me to Franklin. She knew what the Civil War meant, and she wanted her grandson growing up in Alabama to see it. But when you stood in battlefields as opposed to smaller sites, you could imagine. And first you could imagine just the battle that took place, and then you could think about the decision making. But if you really start imagining, then you start thinking about why did it happen and what did it mean.
I tell you what, reading comic books helped me, because I remember when the Black Panther came out and he was an African hero, and I naturally gravitated towards him because I saw someone who looked like me in comic books. And then there was the Falcon, and then there was Power Man. I'm a Marvel guy, but I remember looking for myself in comic books, and that was important to me and my friends, just as it is today when we see ourselves in movies portrayed in a positive light. Martin Luther King said there's a poison that's within the body politic that is destroying America from the inside out. And every now and then it boils over into violence. And when the television cameras saw that, because you're fire hosing children and sending attack dogs out on elderly women, that hopefully you'll turn the mirror around and look at yourself and see what you have become. And really, that's what it took for America to see on national television what was going on. Because until that time, until it went public, it wasn't thought of as a bad thing. You know, the Negroes are here in their place, we're here in our place. As long as we don't cross, everything is okay. And it was displayed across the country. America took a deep look at itself, and by loving the hell out of your neighbor, that was the goal, to do just that. I'm not going to retaliate evil for evil, violence for violence. I'm going to love you into submission. I'm hoping that your conscience will be convicted enough where your heart will change.
The war turned out to be far more costly than anybody could have ever imagined. Almost 700,000 killed, roughly 2% of the population, equivalent to losing 7 million today. And there was one casualty left, and that was Abraham Lincoln, the great emancipator himself.
The war had kind of eased into its violence in a way, but still to have the president assassinated, the country had never experienced that before. It's the first really political assassination here in the United States. I just don't think people even thought it was possible. I think that it was something that wasn't even in the cards. It also came at the end of the war, at this moment where it seemed like it was going to be finished. Lincoln was already thinking about what the aftermath of the war was going to look like. So to have this one last kind of violation of humanity at the end of the war was still unfathomable.
By the time Lincoln was assassinated, the 13th Amendment to the Constitution had been passed by Congress. Almost on a parallel track with that is the survivors, the people of the United States, are attempting to deal with death and its immense cost, and you begin to see the creation of national cemeteries and Confederate cemeteries like the one at Carnton. But there's also great political upheaval.
The Freedmen's Bureau, for instance, was created even before the war ended, because already there's a crisis of what do you do with these folks who have been emancipated, who have emancipated themselves, who have left the South and moved to places where they are free, but they have no land, they have no home, they have no resource. And so how do you help them move forward? And so the Freedmen's Bureau is created to deal with some of those issues, to feed them temporarily, to find land, to negotiate labor contracts, to provide schools, to provide them with the most basic resources, but resources that they've always been denied.
After the 13th Amendment to the Constitution is ratified and slavery is forever abolished, the 14th Amendment is really one of the most transformational changes to our Constitution. It's an amendment to this day that's regularly invoked. And what it did was guaranteed the right of citizenship. And at the time, it was guaranteeing the right of citizenship to African Americans. That was really at its core, was to establish previous conditions of servitude need not apply, that if you were born in this country or naturalized, you were a citizen of the country. A couple of years later, the 15th Amendment to the Constitution is ratified, and it was profound because it guaranteed the right to vote to African American men. But of course, I think one of the things that we deal with today is this really lingering myth that Reconstruction was a failure, when in truth, Reconstruction had many successes. All one has to do is look at these three amendments. Reconstruction was not a failure. The failure, perhaps, is that Reconstruction ended.
In 1877, there's a backroom deal. Southern Democrats agree to allow Rutherford B. Hayes, the Republican candidate, to have the presidency if radical Republicans agree to end forced Reconstruction in the South. The other thing that happens is a Supreme Court ruling in 1883 that completely overturns the Civil Rights Act of 1875. And in the majority opinion on that, Justice Joseph Bradley says, you know, there comes a point when emancipated slaves simply need to take responsibility for themselves. They cannot go on being the special favorite of the law. Now, I think if you'd ask any African American in America at that time, did they consider themselves to be a special favorite of the law, they would have said no. And I don't understand how 18, 19 years of being a special favorite somehow overturns 250 years of being obviously not the special favorite of anybody.
We also throw out any dream of a happily ever after moment. The people who used to be in charge, they take charge once again. And those amendments that we worked so hard to pass, they start trying to figure out ways to subvert them. We subtly take those rights away that we had bestowed upon these freedmen. It would take us many years in order to hold ourselves to the words written in those amendments.
It's not long after this Civil Rights Act is passed in 1875 that Ulysses S. Grant's second term as president ends, and Reconstruction is brought to really almost an immediate halt. And within years, the era that we know as Jim Crow begins.
I were tremendous blow into the third tier in right field.
And it enables us to embrace the whole of America. An America that we love. An America that, almost alone in the world today, recognizes and pays tribute to those who give of their best, regardless of creed, race, or color.
For your kindness, it has made me feel very, very humble. And I shall always hold it as a beacon for anything that I may be able to do in the future. I sincerely hope I shall always be a credit to my race and to the motion picture industry. My heart is too full to tell you just how I feel. And may I say thank you. God bless you.
Freedom for 4 million people was supposed to lead to equality, but it took a lot longer than many would have ever anticipated. It really wasn't until the aftermath of another great war, World War II, that you see the sparks of the modern civil rights movement.
You've had young black men that served their country, and they were overseas, and they come home to places like Mississippi, Alabama, South Carolina, even places in the North. They recognize they're not being treated as full citizens.
They had volunteered in droves, and then they come home to America, where they should be greeted as heroes, and instead they find racism right here.
There they were, fighting, dying, serving their country, and they come back and they start asking questions.
In 1946, a young naval veteran from World War II named James Stevenson had come back home to his hometown, Columbia, Tennessee, and he and his mother went to a store inquiring about a repair that was being done, and they started being harassed by the white repairman. And he was just sick and tired of it. He felt like his family didn't deserve that treatment. And a physical altercation came about as a result of this. And what followed this altercation was a riot in Colombia that was horrific. Multiple prisoners were shot while in jail. Many people view this event in Colombia as the tipping point, the snowball that would push towards the civil rights movement as we have come to know it from the 1950s and 60s.
Separate but equal was supposed to be separate but equal. Well, it was separate, except it was anything but equal. When Stevenson gets into his altercation, it's almost 20 more years, almost another generation before we get to the landmark Civil Rights Act of 1964, which really is an echoing of the Civil Rights Act of 1875. I mean, think about that. It was 90 years from the time the first one was passed to when the next one was passed and then was not overturned by the United States Supreme Court. And then the Voting Rights Act of 1965, which really is congressional legislation meant to shore up a constitutional amendment. So yeah, almost a century. And since then, we've made tremendous progress, but it took a long time.
All of the leaders in the civil rights movement, I think all the participants in the civil rights movement, understood that we had been trying for 200 years to grow into this idea of all men created equal.
Congratulations, Mr. President.
And we had made forward steps and then stalled and sometimes even made backward steps.
The crowd again has gone back
like
to the
violence have been confined to South Central Los Angeles.
And they knew they had a part to play, and we were on a threshold. We were at an important moment where things simply could not continue as they had before. And whether they were making a small step, like Rosa Parks keeping her seat, or a Medgar Evers who is out beating the bushes, getting people registered to vote, or Malcolm X who is going to say, by any means necessary, change has to come, or a Martin Luther King Jr. who is going to, by his own example, say, you know what, let him kick you, let him arrest you, let him do all of the horrible things, but continue to stand up for what is right. All of them were in their own way saying, somebody has to listen and it's time. And we will not stop doing whatever we have to do until something changes.
The Civil War in that era seems so far away, but it's not that far away. You can hopscotch back a couple generations and have people who were born in the immediate aftermath of slavery, people who were born with that social order still very much prevalent in their world. And those things get handed down. They do, they die a very slow death. That doesn't just change overnight. There's that great line in The Raisin in the Sun, 1959, Lorraine Hansberry's great play, where the younger family is gonna move into Clyburn Park, the white neighborhood. And the white representative comes out and tries to buy him out of moving in. Of course, their conversation, he says you can't just force people to change what's in their heart. And I think that that lingers in the South for a long time. People learn to be quiet about it, not say things in polite company, begrudgingly accept certain things. But I think that that change in their heart is a long time coming.
I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land.
Created equal. Now, our local governments, as the mayor has just, are taking leadership in making Dr. King's dream a reality as we begin to tell the fuller story.
I just talked about the idea of indifference. It's easy to forget, not intentionally to forget. You just move on, you know, you're not thinking about it. I think the ground encourages us to think about it. Some people choose to visit it. And when you choose to visit, you're making an active choice to remember, to think about this. Of course, you can't choose to remember the ground, choose to visit the ground if it's not there.
I think there is a power in place. The story of the Battle of Franklin is a compelling story, the stories of the families who lived here. And I could tell you that story sitting in a coffee shop. To be in the room upstairs where there is blood soaked into the floor and talk about the men who poured out everything they had to preserve the Union or to fight for something that they believed in. To watch a fifth grader approach one of those bullet holes in the wall and put his hand inside it and see his face trying to wrestle with exactly what he's experiencing. There's power in those places to stand on the battlefield where Americans killed Americans. Something happens there, something visceral, a connection that does not happen anywhere else.
I think about when I visit a Civil War battlefield, come to a place like Carton, and you walk in, and you think about that it happened here. You can't look away as easily. And we're looking over here at these parlors, and just to think about the night of November 30th, that these would have been stacked full of young men who were wounded. To be able to walk into the space, you can almost close your eyes and see those young men still on the floor. And if this space doesn't exist, you can't do that.
A place like this is where the institution that led us to war existed. And then, on this very ground, you see a terribly vicious battle fought at the end of a long four-year war. And then, you also see the post-war years. So I think Franklin is truly special because you can see pre-war, the war, and the post-war. When I first visited over 20 years ago, I couldn't believe what I saw. On two different levels, I was incredibly, profoundly moved by the Carter House, by Carnton, by the Confederate Cemetery, by the Confederate Monument, by the ground that was covered up. I think you have to stand on the ground just north of Carnton and look across what we now call the Eastern Flank Battlefield Park and imagine this throng, thousands of Southern troops advancing in this last great charge, and that it used to be a golf course.
It's difficult when we talk about Confederate monuments because I think there's so many different people who have different views on what they are and what they mean. They were also put up at many different times and were put up commemorating different things. Many of them, like the one here in Franklin, was put up to remember the men who fought and died in the war. Others were put up to certain individuals, oftentimes in areas where they fought or where they were from. Some were put up of certain individuals in areas where they never existed. A monument is really what it represents. It itself is not history. We are now coming up on around 400 years since African Americans were brought to this country as slaves. And remember, the Civil War was 150 years ago. Slavery existed in this country for a long time, longer than we've been a free country. We were maybe not existing as the United States, but we existed as an area that allowed slavery and that allowed slavery to grow. I think that this is something that we have dealt with ever since, and I think this is something that we will always have to grapple with. We'll always have to grapple with the fact that our founders were men who, many of them, I think, really believed that all men were created equal, and many of them also were people who owned other human beings. That will never change. That will always be a part of our origin as a country. But I think, like Martin Luther King Jr. believed, that phrase was a promissory note to future generations.
You know, the guys who survived this on both sides, they wanted us to see it. They wanted posterity to come here, not to, you know, wallow in the bloodshed, but they wanted people to see it. They wanted people to know that something important had happened here on both sides, but there were other stories to be told. They both existed in the same realm, slavery, the Confederacy, white, black, rich, poor, all existed in the same place in 1850 and 1860 and 1870. Why couldn't we tell all the stories? And that, I think, is a challenge. Some people simply don't want to deal with all the elements of history. It's not always supposed to make you feel good, and it's not always supposed to make you upset. You can do both, and you can do both in the same place. And hopefully you can do both in the same place right here in Franklin. And 50 years from now, someone will read the markers and look at the monument, walk on the battlefield, and they won't remember any of us. But they'll know what happened here.
Thank you. ever since the city's founding, 220 years ago this month, there has never been any kind of permanent representation of African Americans on the square. But thankfully, with these markers, all of that changes today. Tennessee is known for being the birthplace of the KKK. Bedford County, Tennessee is known for being the birthplace of Nathan Bedford Forrest. Nashville, Tennessee is known for being the birthplace of the United Daughters of the Confederacy. But I stand here today to let you know that Franklin, Tennessee will be known for being the birthplace of the Fuller Story. October 17th, 2019 is truly a day of redemption. October 17th is a day of recognition. It is a day of remembrance. It is a day of representation. And thanks be to God, it is a day of rejoicing. Thank you.